Welcome, online viewers. My name is Arjon Dunnewind, and I'm here in the tech booth of het Huis Utrecht. And normally, I wouldn't be allowed to go here, but tonight is special, and I'll tell you why in a minute. You're here to see Game Over, a philosophical watch party by Italian philosopher Franco Bifo Berardi and Rotterdam-based actress Anna Sijbrands. And Anna is here with us in Utrecht in the theater hall, and Franco Bifo Berardi will be joining us from Bologna. And the event that we made is based on a text that Franco Bifo Berardi published in e-flux. We put this text online on our website, so if you have difficulties following us, you can go and read the text also on our website. And we changed this text into an online theatrical performances, an online theatrical performance with text and video. And sorry for that. And I, in a way, I'm the director of this performance, and that's why I'm here in the tech booth of het Huis Utrecht. To help and assist the technicians from IMPAKT and from het Huis Utrecht with making the right switches and transitions. The transitions between Bologna and Utrecht, and the transitions between the live recorded events here and in Bologna, and the videos that we have and will insert in this session. So the session, we think, will about 30 minutes long. And we don't know, it's live, so we're going to see. We think it's about 30, 40 minutes long. And after the session, we'll have time to take your questions in a short Q&A with Franco Bifo Berardi. You can send your questions to questions@impakt.nl, and we'll take them in this short Q&A. So now, without any further ado, we'll go to Franco Bifo Berardi.
Children. On March 15, 2019, in many cities around the world, 1 million children marched under the banner of climate strike. Why should we go to school? Why should we prepare for a future that we will not have? We want you to panic. Then what? This movement is a rebellion against extinction. Simultaneously, this is the beginning of a culture of transitoriness and of rage against those who have engendered us. Zain, the protagonist of the movie Capernaum, directed by Nadine Labaki, is a 12-year-old Syrian boy who lives chaos of Beirut. Zain was not marching with Greta Thunberg and other youth activists on March 15, 2019. Having been summoned by a judge, he demands that his parents be prosecuted for the crime of birth to him.
بس يعرفوا انه عندك ولد الا يطيروك
طيب واطلع الا قلبي ماشي انت هون
قدام اشتكي على حد
ليه
هم خلفوني
The inn is the perfect symbol of the children's crusade that is mounting everywhere. An immense crowd of innocent victims want to know why they have been compelled to abandon the blank immortality of eternal nothingness. Why they have been summoned, assembled in this awkward city of violence, in the sad murkiness of precarity and anguish. Why did you force me out of my space of dispassionate non-being into the fog and fury of exhaustion?
It is not the world that is sinking, but a jumble of my synaptic circuits. Entropy is expanding down there, blurring vision, clouding meaning, obstructing any path of escape. We are not dealing with the disintegration of the universe or with the undoing of the social foundation, but rather with the unstoppable degradation of my nervous cells. But reality at the end of the day is but the dynamic projection of countless experiences of mental decay.
Kronos and Cosmos. The relation between Cronos and his son Zeus was troubled, they said. Gods in the age of chaos swallowed his own sons because he had been told that his destiny was to be overthrown by one of them. The goddess Rhea, however, tricked Cronos by getting him to swallow a rock and hid Zeus in a cave on the island of Cronos. His father Cronos became the king of the gods and the architect of the universe and turned chaos into cosmos. Time, the great destroyer, must be chained up in order for an eternal order to be imposed on the world. Order is into chaos. Eventually, the mind rebuilds structures and restores mental order so that chaos leads to cosmos, then cosmos collapses again. This cycle is well known. This is how our experience unfolds in time. Time and structure play their infinite game onto different structures because structures are immutable and eternal, but time is the decomposer of all structures and the agent of the extinction of all things in the structural universe. Temporality does not exist. Kronos is chained in the living universe of temporality. Structures are continuously dissolved. Kronos unchained. The mind is the only place where these two universes coexist. The universe of life. Digital Mephistopheles. In the realm of matter, and particularly in the realm of biological matter, extinction is the destiny of every entity, both of individual particularities and of collective multiplicities. However, throughout the course of evolution, the human mind has succeeded in the search for eternity by creating the sphere of abstraction, pure mathematical relation independent from physical matter and therefore preserved from death. The mind, indeed, is the only dimension in which order dwells and where the immortal can be found, mathematical order. But we should not forget that the human mind is embodied. This bodily nature implies that individual mind is subject to the effects of time, decay, and extinction. Mind is the source of abstraction, immortality, but also the domain of sensitive duration. Organic architecture lives and dies like all perishable material substances. This is why mathematical reason cannot indefinitely coexist with a sensitive organism. In the long run, the insertion of mathematical entities into the continuum of social life engenders little disturbances, nervous breakdowns. Mathematics is the mental dimension in which extension is replaced by relation, the realm of immateriality in which time is irrelevant. No struck a deal with Mephistopheles, but Faust did not realize that the best path to immortality is the mathematization of the world. Since you want to live forever, says the digital Mephistopheles to the transhumanist Faust, you will be recombined into the immortal abstraction of the automaton.
Scars that can't be seen. I've got drama, can't be stolen. Everybody knows me now.
Mathematization. The global cognitive automaton is under construction in the sphere of computation. The process of constructing the automaton is asymptotic, ever expanding and never finished. Its genealogy is rooted in the history of the modern mathematization of the world.
Galileo, in Il Saggiatore, was persuaded that philosophy is written in the great book of the universe, which is continuously open in front of our eyes, but cannot be realized if we don't learn the language in which it is written. It is written in the language of mathematics, and its characters are triangles, circles, and other geometric forms. If we ignore them, we cannot understand a single word of the universe, and we are doomed to faintly wander in a labyrinth of darkness.
Mathematization is not only a methodology for the theoretical formalization of natural phenomena. It is also a process of technical determination, the digitalization of linguistic and physical processes in the late modern age has proceeded to insert mathematical functions into the living body of language and social exchange. The establishment of a conventional standard for measuring space and time and the ensuing reduction of entities to commensurability is the core of modern science. It is also the precondition of capitalism, a social system that is based on the conventional equalization of all produced goods, both material and semiotic. Since the common measure of value is based on socially necessary labor time, time itself has been reduced to computation. The mechanical computabilization of time was at the core of the Industrial Revolution, the objectivation of time as a social, economic, and cultural dynamics of capitalism. Thanks to the mathematization of the world and to the computabilization of time, the mental sphere emancipates itself from the dimension of perishability, abstraction. It's not subject to the rule of death.
From the circle, always noise and struggle, failure and filth, but here, all has been perfected. The best people had made the best systems, and the best systems had reaped funds, unlimited funds, that made possible this, the best place to work.
Not the strongest, nor the greatest will survive. But only the ones that adapt to the change of the context. For 100,000 years, life has proceeded invariably without hikes and without peaks, in the unwavering balance of life and reproduction. No increment of productivity, pure reoccurrence of the same. Then the horizon suddenly expanded and scrambled the old beliefs. Capitalism is acceleration, and acceleration enables expansion. Capitalism is the only successful mechanism for economic growth. Capitalism is a corpse that longs for eternity and jolts in electrocution, then finally rests in the frozen immortality of abstraction, constant expansion of death in the sphere of the living. Those who resist will lose. Only will survive those who comply with the inevitable. Those who will recombine living cells according to a more flexible design. Did you remark that America, the most powerful military monsters of all times, has lost all the wars waged in the last 15 years, and in a sublime paradox of the evolution, this nation that is by far the most ignorant among those which inhabit the planet, the most dumb and the most arrogant, presides over the imagination of the whole of mankind thanks to its media corporations and its technical apparatuses. This is why the humankind is doomed. This is why the United States of America is the terminal illness of the human kind. Bigot barbarians have trampled democracy, the idol of those who thrive on our distress. And now they are devouring the neoliberal lackeys of mathematical ferocity, but they cannot devour the abstraction itself, because abstraction cannot be devoured. The lugubrious idiots are winning the heart of the humiliated crowds, and they are going to slaughter each other for the sake of their fucking gods, of their fucking nations, of their fucking identities, of their fucking nothingness, because this is the only thing fascists can do. Let's wait for the end of the dog's breakfast. If something will remain, someone will murmur calmly the word communism as a sign of possible friendship after the end of this impending horror. In the origin of times, continents broke apart in a pandemonium of smoke and black powder, and the colossal tyrannosaurs were swallowed by the immensity of vulcans. They tried to resist, clenching enormous stones, but when the magma is unleashed, stones turn into dust. The magma that simmers inside the inmost volcano that is unknown to us. Therefore, I predict that tyrannosaurs will perish, and we will perish with them. Nevertheless, we know that dying is not the worst of evil. Rather, the only way to get free from the pain that you are inflicting on us, you, Lord of the hosts. You, master of our labor, you, universal equivalent measuring the exchange value of meaninglessness, you, abstract light, you, alpha and omega, you, frightening harbinger of long-desired apocalypses.
Abstraction, eternity, extinction. Paradoxically, however, the insertion of abstraction into social life and the cycles of the natural environment is leading to the extinction of concreteness and of life itself. The damnation or salvation of that is denied in the realm of abstraction. Extinction is not only a possibility in the sphere of pure mathematical relations. This is why capitalism is eternal. And, unluckily enough, this is why humankind seems to be doomed. The eternity of capitalism, in fact, is based on the annihilation of life through the process of abstraction. Abstract value has taken the upper hand and has subjugated the concreteness of life, of production, consumption, and language. Thanks to the digital network, financial capitalism has detached the economy from the sphere of perishable things. The concrete activity of producing useful things has been subsumed, recorded, and finally abolished by the mathematical rule of financial capitalism. The unintended consequence of this is the annihilation of life. The eternal survival of capitalism is enabled by the expansion of debt, so that in the end, we dwell inside.
Rilke, The Eight Elegy. Never, not for a single day, do we have pure space before us, which the flowers are always unfolding. It's forever world, and never nowhere without not the pure and unwanted over air we breathe. Know infinitely, and do not want. As when sometimes a child gets lost in the silence and has to be shaken back.
Dark zeitgeist. The contemporary subconscious is marked by two powerful gravitational pulls. Into each other. The insertion of mathematical exactitude into the living continuum of the vibrational organism has led to the ossifying of biodiversification. The insertion of digital connection into the continuum of bodily conjunction has led to the syntactic ossifying. The allure of extinction and immortality has polarized the social unconscious. A nihilistic drive emerges in aesthetics and politics. Decline and the fear of extinction are fueling ethno-nationalist culture worldwide, and in particular, a wave of aggressive white supremacism when he perceives that he will soon be replaced. But the white male, in his historical domination, has produced the conditions for a larger extinction, climate change, global civil war, and psychotic collapse. This might lead to the real extinction, imagined extinction of the white supremacists. At the same time, a frozen immortality emerges in the form of the global cognitive automaton. This immortality results from the unraveling of the senior capitalist abstraction and from the insertion of bioinfotech devices into language. Inorganic intelligence into the conjunction between your bodies acts as an extinguisher of life and of living consciousness. Those extinction looms on the horizon as the ultimate destiny of history.
Tycho Spodinov, Dave Eggers, The Circle. I didn't intend any of this to happen, and it's moving so too fast. The idea of completion, it's far beyond what I had in mind when I started all this, and it's far beyond what's right. It has to be brought back into some kind of balance. I was trying to make the web more civil. I was trying to make it more elegant. I got rid of anonymity. I combined 1,000 disparate elements into one unified system. But I didn't picture a world where circle membership was mandatory, where all government and all life was channeled through one network. There used to be the option of opting out, but now that's over. Completion is the end. We are closing the circle around everyone. It's a totalitarian nightmare.
What extinction am I talking about? The answer to this question is not clear to me. Does this extinction concern the human race or the cultural construct that we call human civilization? Social integration is collapsing, but at the same time, the process of civilization has culminated in the self-construction of the automaton, which impassively takes shape in the connective space. Collapse, global civil war, nuclear proliferation, and epidemics of panic and depression are steps towards extinction. But this is not the end of the world, since abstraction has created a world of its own, subsuming social language and prescribing the social forms of interaction.
No. 20th century medicine aimed to heal the sick. 21st century medicine is increasingly aiming to upgrade the healthy. In the 20th century, medicine benefited the masses, because the 20th century was the age of the masses. 20th century armies needed millions of healthy soldiers, and economies needed millions of healthy workers.
Expansion and acceleration have been fostered by the cultural erasure of transitoriness. Investing time in economic value has been a way to simulate eternity, private property, accumulation, and the sacrifice of the present on the altar of the future. This cycle of sacrifice, investment, and expansion has been the strength of capitalism. Now, it's over. The physical resources of the planet and the nervous energies of society are on the path to final exhaustion. the collapse of vision of the future has paved the way for reflecting on a previously transhumanist utopians, for their part, indulge in fantasies about imminent promises of high-tech immortality. But hypocritical tech cheerfulness and contemporary nihilism are based on a shared vision of the ineluctable. It's too late to stop devastation and climate collapse of the hyperconnected mind. This helps to explain the nonsensical increase of inequalities that marks that the wealth distribution of our time. The predators think that it is impossible to stop the extinction process in their calculation. All they can do is protect themselves of enormously expensive panic and cynicism prevail in the terminal psychosphere. Coda. Is there a way out from this end? Yes, of course. It is you. After 3 years of full immersion in the laboratory of future sensibilities, I came back to my country and, together with a group of friends, I staged Game Over, a video electronic poem in an art space called The Public Secret of Bologna. The Gang of Four was on trial in Beijing in those days. Bangung Van symbolized the defeat of our generation. I spent hours in a Naples cafe playing video games. The first generation of video games came in large metal boxes with screen. I fought little green men in a game called Space Invaders. I was impressed by the end of the game. After inevitable defeat, two words appeared on the screen: game over. Nowadays, these two words no longer pop up on the screen because players of the new generation are aware of the automaton. They have internalized it. But together with the poet Enzo Crosio, I wrote a poem. Based on the poem, my brother wrote music for a concert with four voices. The Gang of Four are playing video games in front of electronic screens and they chant.
The exponential function of electronic speed knocks down one after the other the functions of biological reactivity. Sooner or later you lose. The machine always wins. Now the trial begins. The conviction is certain. War is declared, and it's going to be a war of extermination.
Then, Chang Chung Chao, the dogmatic intellectual from Shanghai, yells, "What is a crime? What is a crime? What is a crime? Is crime the inducer of chaos or the generator of order?"
welcome, viewers at home. And I'm here. I hope I'm joined by Franco. Franco, are you there?
I'm here, yes.
Super. Thanks a lot for your performance, for reading and performing your text Game Over, as it was published in e-flux. And we can take a few questions from the audience. I forgot to take my tablet. Maybe someone can hand me the tablet that we use to get and take questions from the audience. And let me see what we have here. There's a question from Jackie. And she says, "This is a thought-provoking performance, and it reminds me of the concept of voluntary human extinction movement. How do you see the connection between your ideas and this voluntary human extinction movement?" And she follows, "In relation to that, do you regard human extinction as the best solution to the current problems facing the Earth and humanity?" How about that for a question, Franco?
Well, I know nothing about the movement of voluntary human extinction. If that exists, I want to be part of it. Yes, I mean, we should come to terms with the idea that, let me be frank, that the Western culture, the white race, that does not exist, of course. It's an abstraction, but it's a powerful form of aggressive identification. Well, all this is dying. It's dying. In the last page of his book about time and order, Carlo Rovelli reminds that we should relax on this point of disappearing. We will disappear. The only way to escape the horrible perspective of extinction is to relax on that point, the point of extinction itself. That is my point. I mean, obviously we are not making serious political elaborations. We are just saying something that is too much hyperbole. Hyperbole. You know what the hyperbole is? Hyperbole and irony. This is my way to deal with the hell.
But that's a terrible and pessimistic message for a festival, for all the people here that still think that we can somehow counter this. I mean, you seem without any hope. I know you as a passionate and very motivated and driven person. The message that you're sending is, as you just explained, I mean, quite pessimistic and dark. Maybe you can expand on that.
Well, first of all, it's not a problem of pessimism and optimism. I am in very good humor, in very good mood. So I have no reasons to be a pessimist. Just I try to to think about what's happening. And I want to join a person who is beyond any suspicion, the Pope, my homonymous Pope, Francesco, who said at the beginning of his, how do you call it, of his incumbents as Pope, at the beginning in October 2013, in an interview published by La Civiltà Cattolica, he said, more or less, of course, I am interpreting Francesco. I hope he will forgive me. He said, God is busy, so he's not caring about us. He is busy somewhere. He has something more important to do than take care of us. So faith is not helping. Don't go around trying to convert Muslims and Jews and atheists. Converting is not our business. One. Second, if we have no faith, if we do not expect something from God because God is busy, also hope is not working, you know? Hope is empty. Faith, hope, compassion. So Francesco says, more or less, we are left only one of the three theological virtues: charity, compassion, empathy, solidarity. We are not supposed to convert those who are suffering. We are supposed to heal them, to do something like kissing them, even if it is forbidden by the COVID-19 rule. The physical embrace, the physical compassion, the church, said Francesco, has to be conceived as, he says, un ospedale da campo. That means a war hospital.
There's a next question, and it connects a bit to what you maybe already addressed, but still I'll ask it. It's from Eric, and he's asking, do you agree that the period just before the extinction will be the most scary? How close are we?
Yes, actually, the problem is not extinction, because that should be easy. You know, the problem is the process that is already leading us to extinction. The problem is racism, is war, hyper-exploitation, precarization, misery, humiliation. This is the problem. Many people think that it's better to short this period and by extinction with some pills. But I think that if we are able to understand that message, the message of compassion, of egalitarianism, of togetherness, if we manage to come out from the corpse of capitalism, well, extinction is a joke. We don't care about extinction. Even if Carlo Rovelli says that sooner or later, everybody is going to know the threshold of extinction, not only the individual organism, but also the global organism of mankind, we don't care about that. If we are able to create a condition for enjoying what we have, if we stop thinking that the problem is having much, having more, if we stop thinking that growth, expansion is the only way, well, I think that relaxing is the only way to escape the prospect, the very likely prospect of extinction.
Okay. Thanks a lot. We're taking just a few questions as we agreed on. And thanks a lot, Anna Sijbrands, for being with us here in the theater hall and reading a few of the quotes that Franco Bifo Berardi included in his text Game Over. If you want to read the text again, it's still available on e-flux. You can also find it on our website. And of course, Franco, I would like to thank you very much for being with us in this experiment, this online performance. Thanks a lot. And now it's time to move on to IMPAKT TV.
It's a pleasure to be with you. Ciao.
Ciao, you're welcome.